Now, without any trouble, okay? And welcome to this Global Justice Report. It's a new emission of this series of online productions of the Center for Global Justice. My name is Roberto Robles, and I'm your host for today's program. El Centro para la Justicia Global, or Center for Global Justice, is a multinational and bilingual research center in San Miguel de Allende in Mexico. The center is devoted to research and learning for a better world. Since 2004, we have offered educational programs both in English for expats and visitors and in Spanish for local community or larger audience. We have also organized educational travels both to Chiapas in Mexico and to Cuba. And our vision is to move control of the economic life and relations with Mother Nature from Earth, from the 1% to the 99%. Coronavirus is set up a relief in the failures of neoliberal capitalism, and our weekly Global Justice Report will explore various grassroots democratic solutions, including self-management, cooperatives, mutual aid, public banking, and more. If you have more suggestions, more topics that you would like that we treat, please send us an email. The email is this one, is global.justice.cliff@gmail.com. The same email, we're gonna use it for today's questions and comments. So if you have one question or one comment, please send this to this email, and we should address lately in the questions and answers section. Okay. Well, for today's session, we are proud to welcome, in the first place, Primer Secretario Zahir Ramsés Cira Méndez, quien es politólogo por la Universidad de los Andes, especialista en procesos políticos latinoamericanos por CLACSO, UMED, especialista en Estado, Gobierno y Democracia, CLACSO, y CEI, primer secretario de la Embajada de Venezuela en la República Federativa del Brasil y en la República de Ecuador. Bueno, he's going to start talking, and later on we're going to have as well al ministro consejero Andrés Eloy Ruiz. Okay, so for the first part, we're gonna have Zahir Ramsés talking. So Zahir, please. So, welcome, Zahir.
Thank you very much, Roberto, Betsy, and all in this room. I'm going to talk in English. I'm going, quiero pedirle disculpas for this English is very bad, but la intención is talk with you. Well, good morning to all the people who from a distance attend this activity and accompany us today. We are pleased and thank you for your presence. Please receive a greeting of behalf of our ambassador, Francisco Javier Arias Cárdenas, and all the diplomatic staff of the embassy of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela to Mexico. I want Roberto, me está comentando, disculpa, el ministro que no puede ingresar. Es la misma liga.
Sí, 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 es la misma.
Ya. Ok. We call on this occasion to share and report on the situation of the COVID-19 and the situation of economic war against Venezuela that the government of the United States have deployed in conjunction with 20 countries and under the submission and obedience of the financial and commercial system international. Te quiero pedir, Roberto, si tú crees pertinente que lo haga en castellano, no hay inconveniente tampoco, por favor, tú me indicas.
No, I don't think no creo que sea conveniente, porque sí, la audiencia es de habla inglesa, pocos hablan español.
¿Quieres que coloquemos el documento? ¿Puedes colocar el documento en como fondo? ¿O me das un permiso para acceder a compartir mi pantalla?
Ya lo tengo, ya ahorita lo pongo en pantalla.
Ahí creo que estoy compartiendo la pantalla, ¿no?
A ver. Sí.
Ok.
No. Sí, ya está.
Perfecto.
Ok.
Igual voy comentándolo en castellano, ¿no? Bueno, la intención, como les comentaba, era hablar o dar un reporte acerca de la situación del COVID en nuestro país y la situación también que viene pasando Venezuela a partir de la guerra económica que se desarrolla por parte del gobierno de los Estados Unidos, ¿no? Desde finales aproximadamente de 2015 y que ha contado con el apoyo de 20 países, ¿no? En este sentido, queremos conversar un poco sobre el territorio nuestro, ¿no? Venezuela tiene un territorio de aproximadamente 916.000 kilómetros cuadrados, si incluimos el territorio del Esequibo, ese territorio aumenta a más de 1 millón de kilómetros cuadrados, con una población que llegaba en el 2014 a los 30 millones de habitantes.
Activo.
Sí, aquí ya creo que se conectó el ministro Andrés Eloy.
Uh-huh.
Sí.
Sí, pero está abierto, creo que tengo por...
Sí, ya aquí está el ministro. ¿Nos escucha, ministro? Sí, nos escucha, ministro.
Sí, los escucho, ahora sí los escucho.
Perfecto. Gracias,
estaba enredado con esto.
Estábamos hablando sobre el territorio venezolano, ministro. Le cedo la palabra.
Bueno, gracias. Teníamos unas palabras. No sé si las estaba siguiendo. Seis.
Sí, las estaba siguiendo. Nos quedamos en conversando sobre el territorio venezolano, el Esequibo.
Y puede hablar en español, ¿verdad? ¿O no?
Estaba yo leyendo el documento en inglés. Si quieres, siga el documento.
Okay. The situation about the Venezuelan country is that is the small country that have only 32 million of people, 16,000 of kilometers, and the Venezuelan economy, however, did not lead in the leading of the most strategically important industrial sector. When you show the more important sector of industry in the world, the first time, the community, communication technology, software and IT, biology, technology and pharmaceutical sector, aerospace sector, financial sector, military sector, and oil and gas sector. In this six sector, only one industry, gas and petroleum sector, have a enterprise of Venezuela. PDVSA is the only enterprise that have space in the international context of the high six sector of the industry in the world, a strategic industry in the world. But how could this small country be an unusual and extraordinary threat to the greatest economy and the military power for the moment? Really, what could be a threat? The argument of the unusual and extraordinary threat of the United States government against Venezuela is a small screen to cover up the total disrespect from the principle of the self-determination of people and was postulated to hide the true intention. To true intention to appropriate the natural resource, renewable and non-renewable, and the intention to impose an unilateral and neocolonial order to Venezuela, as has imposed on countries in Europe, Asia, and America. The undeclared war against Venezuela was triggered by the arrival of the Bolivarian Revolution in the power in Venezuela in 1999 to the sale of the Venezuelan people to their own destiny. Is this a purpose of imposing domination on a people that has 200 years ago had the conviction of being free and surviving? The economic, military, and communication war against Venezuela does not seek the welfare and protection of the people, nor does it claim any principle that defends international law, nor does it aspire to establishment of democracy of defense of the human race. The unilateral wealth of the four generations seek the imposition of a political model of submission, the multiplication of social inequality and the appropriation of goods and wealth on Venezuela by a foreign nation. This is need to be clear and explicit. The war was defined and started in 2001 when the Bolivarian government enacted laws establishes the legal framework to develop the aspect establishment in the Constitution of the Bolivarian Republic, which has approved by a popular vote in 1999. Through these 19 years, this war has gone through several stages, each with a particular emphasis with a movement that has been having as the core of the development from the internal space to the external space. In the first times, the United States won to the internal force make a cop of state, but now it's only external force. Since in 2001, the war against the homelands of Simón Bolívar and Hugo Chávez has gone through five states that I briefly mentioned in order to have a better context of what it's like. The free state is from 2001 to 2004. It was focused on the classical element to the overthrow of the government in conformal to the imperial government and military coup. And you remember the situation of April 11 of 2002. Maybe you remember that the military coup have a time of in the power, 2 days, because in April 13, the cop was derrotado. The militar cop fracasó. Wonderful.
Fail.
Thank you, Robert. Well, you can read the situation about the first stage. The first stage is the situation with the internal force, the petroleum worker and the military force. But when the President Chavez win in the referendum in 2004, the first stage is finished. Then the government, the United States government changed to another strategic. That is the situation of the second stage. The second stage is along 3 or 4 years, maybe, is to 2007 to 2010. It began with the second government from Chavez. And the second stage is the more soft because the actions are in the context. For example, in the juridic situation with the media, with media national and foreign to make a homework about the name of the regime. Along 27 to 2010, the media international said about the Chavez government no saying the democratic government. They said about this government that's the regime. That is the technical of the soft cope techniques. Such as those applied in the so-called Spring of Color. You remember Denis Sharp in Serbia and in other countries. The government of the United States and the government of the Union Europea financing through their through the institution of this single organization and individual. It's the time to have a trouble with internal media. We have a trouble with international court in La Haya. Is the attack to the outside to the inside? But the more important strategies is the make the concept about the government of Chavez was a dictatorial regime and not a democratic government. Then recently in 2013, third state, please say. And the third state from 23rd and 2015 is when, okay, thank you. When Chavez dead is the start of the third state. As you might recall, President Hugo Chavez planted himself on March 5, 2013,
and filing to exercise his constitutional mandate. This moment is the start when the third stage began. Along 2 years, in 2013 and 2014, Jim's Hastert manual on soft cough were applied with violent actions inside the country. Some organization worked with the people on Venezuela, with the special organization in Venezuela. That is the list of the eight organizations. You can read him in the text. This organization, Albert Einstein Institute, the Canvas Institute, the Net Institute, all that organization worked and financing the action, the violence action of the small group in several cities. Move, please. And in these years, 2013 to 16, along 60 deaths as a result of the violent action of the opposition, including the burning of the health center and the headquarters of a university, including the library, the secretariat and register, and the very smart, very important, the violence is the character of that moment. When the stage finished, this stage finished to start a new stage on the more violence and more pressure over the government and the people of Venezuela. Because in March 8th of 2016, Barack Obama declared by the executive decree national emergency from the United States, because he said that the Venezuelan was a Venezuelan extraordinary threat. And that is the signal to start in new level, and increase and develop of their aggression. Because from 16 to 17, the violence are grown. Along 2 years, more of 163 deaths, many of them civilian, almost all because of the opposition or force. The violence of this year is very incredible, because you can think that there are other people burning another because he think that he have appearance of Chavist, or you don't think that the people would fighting from free, burning a school, a preschool, a place, a school with the children and girls in class. Is the first stage to win to the government? What happened to the government in this time? All time, the government of President Chavez and the government of President Nicolás Maduro called to the dialogue. And in 2017, the President Nicolás Maduro called for election of the National Constituent Assembly. The principle of the Bolivarian Revolution is you can call to the people to decide. and the form is the by-election. That is the form in the 2004. And now, in 2017, President Nicolás Maduro called again to the election because the principal aspect of the Bolivarian Revolution is the people have the power, And then you can call the people to decide what situation he wants. In 2017, the president Nicolás Maduro called for the election of the National Constituent Assembly, ANC, is the principal power of the country. And this election in August 31, he fight and vencer.
To win.
Okay, it's the far to win to the violence, to the aggression against Venezuela, against the people. The action of the election, the ANC, Assemblea, National Constituent Assembly, is the situation to win. Very important because you can see how aggression you can the Bolivarian Revolution win by the Pacific form, by referendum in 2004, by the election of National Constituent Assembly in 2017, by the election of Chavez in 2006. Is the people with the vote the real power? Is not the power supported over arms, over guns. Is the government is supported over the votes of the people. Well, between four states to the five stage, along 1 year, more or less 6 months, six, eight months, the dialogue with the another actor of the opposition after will restart. Presidente Nicolás Maduro start the dialogue and in Dominican Republic make a meeting with the opposition sector. And then I believe, we believe that in January 2018, we have a agreement. But the USA government said to their slave, this say to their political slave in Venezuela, that the break and the coming. And that is the form in February 2018, when the agreement between government and opposition forms is okay. Suddenly, the opposition break the agreement and break the table and restart to the violence form, restart to the another unconstitutional form to take the power of the country. That is the moment of the five stages start, and then the new form to the aggression have a structure of the sanctions or unilateral action from the USA government against Venezuela. And the rest of the year 2018, if is used by the US government to organize alliance with another countries, Colombia, Brazil, Argentina, Peru, Chile, in order in the name of the Lima Group in America. What is the principal purpose of the Lima Group? Could the relationship commercial, could the relationship and the commerce with Venezuela? How say the people who died in Tumangalo? I don't think when they put it. El norteamericano que falleció decía no puedo respirar.
George Floyd.
What say George Floyd?
I can breathe.
That is the similar situation that like the government, the USA government against Venezuela. With the Lima group, like that Venezuela can't breathe. Situation along 2018 years. And then when the President Maduro started a new government in 2019, the situation to take a fighting cope of a state start. That's it, the situation in the 19. In the last year, along the last year, you have a big situation with the muchas situaciones.
Many situations.
Many situations of different form. Internal form have a. Interruption of the supply of electricity, but we have sabotage action in the gas and oil industry. You have sabotage action in the water service. You have sabotage action in the communication and internet home infrastructure on home framework. Along the 2018 years, all action and internal was the sabotage to make this conform to the people. And in external, the stalling of recourse, the stalling of the financial active in the bank, the stalling of the Citgo, the stalling of the all recourse that have the country to and the government to attend the needs of the people. You can see the impact of the situation in this number. For example, you can see the decrease of the foreign exchange income from PDVSA is 90%. In 5 years, the foreign exchange income decrease of 19%. Is when a government or one country have this trouble, have this situation, then he needs use the another recourse. In Venezuelan case, Citgo, Monomeros, Another refinery in Jamaica, República Dominicana, and all these options were impossible because the government stole some time, the USA government stole some time, or the Colombian government stole monomeros, and the small countries don't like conflict with the US government, and then all they cut the relations commercialship with the Venezuelan government. You can see the impact of the economic war. More down, please. Más abajo, Francés. Look the month. Okay. 114 billion dollars only in 7 years. 114 billion dollars is the money or recourse that you need to supply the of medicine and food to the Venezuelan people along 26 years. It's a big amount of recourse. The situation is very difficult because in another country you can send a transfer of recourse to another company to pay vaccines or to pay from food or to pay from medicine. But Venezuela can, it's impossible to Venezuelan government send a transference of dollar to another country. Today I have a meeting with the Canciller Ebrard and other people of the CELAC. They talk about the vaccine with the AstraZeneca. You remember that the last week, Alberto Fernández said about that alliance, and Andrés Manuel López Obrador said too about the alliance with AstraZeneca. Well, AstraZeneca in the 2016, when the Barack Obama signed the order against Venezuela, AstraZeneca left from Venezuela. It's the first company pharmaceutical that left, got out of Venezuela by their own decision. How we can pay to AstraZeneca to buy the vaccine that the Alberto Fernández said and AMLO said? Why? It's impossible. Because you have two situations. One, don't have the money. But when you have the money, you can't pay. Because if you pay by the regular form of the international financial system, the records are stored with the bank. Is the situation in European Bank? Is the situation in Citibank? Is the situation in an American bank? One simple action is very, very difficult from the Venezuelan government, because need to pay in different forms and cover the pay to another people or another intermediario?
Intermediary.
With another intermediary, sometimes, and natural person, or sometimes an enterprise to buy food or to buy medicine. It's the only form to buy in the international market. That is the situation. That is the level of the war. But what now in Venezuela with COVID? Okay, check now, say please.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now,
what happened with the COVID? Well, and the última página.
Yes. I'll change the next.
The right. Next. Well, now have 165 days with the forecast. We have a small country with a public system of health without all recourses that you require, what you need. But we have only 32,607 along 6 months, March, April, May, June, July, along 6 months. That is the number of our situation. We have four action lines. Quarantine, early detection, treatment and medicine to the medicine and treatment against COVID. And the popular organization, the people with the consejos comunales, with the colectivos to contend, to limit the impact of the COVID. We need to say that is the very important, the international cooperation with a few nations that have made available the necessary inputs to address the against the pandemic: Cuba, China, Iran, Russia, and Turkey. The cooperation and the solidarity, international solidarity, is very important, as we vital the collaboration of the WHO and the Red Cross to take the situation in the small level. Well, it's all you can. Okay, it's all.
That's it then.
Okay.
It's all the text. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Do we have any questions, Cliff?
Roberto, viendo la transmisión por YouTube, hay una compañera que nos comenta si las perspectivas después de las elecciones de noviembre van a cambiar. Yo no sé si el ministro pudiera conversar al respecto y que tú nos ayudes un poco a la traducción, porque creo que es bastante pertinente la pregunta. La pregunta la realiza, ya te digo, el nombre se llama Cinti Seigner, quien realiza la pregunta.
Ok.
Ok.
So, I'm going to take the one question that was received by YouTube. This person asks, what would be the importance, the sort of changes after the November elections that has been set up? What would be the reaction? What would be the accomplishments in Venezuela? How important are the elections? Okay.
Okay. In 2016, Democratic Party was in the government. Now, Republic Party are in the government. Both party are the same from Venezuela. We think that another president can be open the door to talk. But the situation is that the real power in USA is an imperialist, like the neocolonial situation for our countries. We'll have the hope that the election can be an opportunity to talk. But some signals are in a positive direction, because you can see that the Venezuelan situation is the campaign team and argument, and in sometimes the both Biden and Trump think that the Florida elector is very important where from their win, and then they show a position against Venezuelan government. But the future is not future, we don't know the future, but we think that the situation might be the same on November.
I have some questions that have come in. Let me, let's see. One says that according to Telesur, yesterday, an additional 212 Cuban doctors arrived in Venezuela, adding to the 20,000 health professionals already there. That solidarity must be a key part of Venezuela's efforts against the COVID. Are there really 20,000 health professionals from Cuba in Venezuela helping out?
Sí, Andrés. Andrés.
Preguntó acerca de la llegada de los médicos cubanos en Venezuela y si eran realmente necesarios.
Que si son 20,000, porque la noticia es que llegaron 200 o algo así de nuevos médicos cubanos.
Ok.
Que se integran a los 20,000+ médicos. La pregunta concreta es si efectivamente hay 20,000 médicos cubanos en Venezuela.
Well, now have a big number of doctors, because we have a alliance in the health system to organize the system of the health. Really. Te voy a responder en español. ¿Ok?
Sí, claro.
Tenemos una alianza de largo tiempo con Cuba para organizar nuestro sistema de salud desde las unidades de barrio, que se llaman Barrio Adentro, y para la formación de médicos.
I'm going to translate little by little. Andres is saying that the relationship with Cuba is from a long time ago. They started, well, Cuba started to teach, to organize the direct attention for the people with the, in the neighborhoods, with the direct attention to the people in the neighborhoods.
La red de medicina preventiva se llama Barrio Adentro. Y allí están médicos cubanos y venezolanos.
Red, yeah, and also to teach the students from Venezuela. So you find now centers with both, with Venezuelan and Cubans doctors.
En algunos momentos pueden haber estado 20.000. Ahorita puede ser que estén 16.000 o pueden haber llegado a 10.000. Varía el número, pero son muchos.
Related to the specific question, it is hard to know how many effective Cuban doctors are already. Perhaps this amount has been reached sometimes, but now perhaps 12 or 2 or 10,000. It's hard to know.
Acerca de lo de ayer, realmente ayer llegaron 200 médicos.
And that's true for sure that it's effective that 200 Cuban doctors arrived yesterday.
Para reforzar los sistemas de salud de la atención contra COVID.
Well, particularly to reinforce the
hospital,
the power to attack the COVID situation.
Okay, another question. One of the most important aspects of the Bolivarian Revolution has been the development of communal councils. Under the present difficult circumstances, how are the communal councils doing? Have they been involved in food distribution in communities, for example?
Sí, Andrés. Sí, la pregunta es directamente reconociendo que los consejos comunales han tenido mucha importancia en la forma que se ha organizado Venezuela. La pregunta en estos tiempos difíciles, ¿qué papel han jugado los consejos comunales, por ejemplo, en la repartición de comida, en la distribución de medicinas, en fin? ¿Qué tan importante han sido los consejos comunales?
Okay. When I said about the COVID situation in Venezuela, I said that we have four lines. Yes? One line is the quarantine. Quarantine really was successful when the old people have a conscience about the importance of the quarantine. The communal council work in order to trabaja en función de acompañar esa conciencia de cada uno. And in the second line, to the early detection of the case, to apply rapid test to check the situation of COVID in the person. Each group of doctor of to make the test have the compañía, tiene la compañía.
Compañía.
Cada grupo de trabajar de médicos que va a hacer las pruebas de detección de salud está acompañado por el Consejo Comunal.
Oh.
15.000 brigadas de salud. Y cada brigada de salud, cuando entra en una comunidad, va de la mano del consejo comunal, que le dice cuál es la casa que hay que visitar y que habla con las personas de esa casa.
Okay, let me tell that. Well, in matters of health attention, the communal councils have a very important role because they are the link between the doctors and the people. For instance, one important thing in order to be effective with the treatment is that people are conscious of the importance of following the instructions. So there are 50,000 brigades, health brigades that work together with the communal councils. So it's the relationship with people is very close. That's the way to make sure that most of the people have attention, are attended, are assisted. Okay.
Roberto, si me permite, un poco para agregar lo que comentaba Andrés y relacionado a lo que decía Cliff, más que el Consejo Comunal, es la organización popular. El consejo comunal es una expresión de eso, pero en realidad es las distintas formas de organización que en el marco de la revolución se han dado, ¿no? Los consejos locales de producción, los CLAP, que permiten la llegada de alimentos en un contexto de bloqueo, los consejos comunales como una forma de gestión de la política pública en la comunidad, pues en el barrio. La comuna como una expresión de lo productivo. Y pudiéramos, bueno, el ministro consejero, seguramente pudiéramos seguir aquí hablando de distintas expresiones de la organización popular, ¿no?
Okay. Well, Zaire wants to make clear that community councils have been very important, but it is only an expression of the popular organization, because within popular organizations you find many structures related to several aspects. For instance, one related with feeding, with food, so they make sure that people has the chance, has the opportunity to get the food they need, for instance. And other means of organizing is to produce food. So many actions are taken within the popular organizations. So it could be a matter of explaining in detail, but there's no time to do so. But it's one of the most important aspects of the revolution, the popular organization.
Thank you for that. I have one question I would like to present, and it goes back to the relationship of the United States to the Bolivarian Revolution. We have seen how the United States government has stolen, and I use the word stolen quite literally, has stolen Venezuela's oil company in the U.S., you know, Citgo, the oil refineries, the retail distribution network, has been taken away from Venezuela. In England, thanks to the U.S. urging, the gold of Venezuela has also been seized, and the government is denied access to that resource in order to buy the medicines and the food that is needed by the population. And now, just last week, we have a report that four tankers carrying oil to Venezuela from Iran have been seized by the U.S. government in international waters. That's piracy, out and out piracy. Well, the Trump administration seems to be willing to go to any measure possible to try to destabilize Venezuela and bring about regime change. That's why, and I'm speaking as a U.S. citizen myself, that's why it is essential that we do away with this administration in Washington, both for our own sake as a nation, but also for the sake of the people of Venezuela, the people of Cuba, the people of Iran, the people of Nicaragua, and on and on and on. The United States is a rogue nation that is destroying the possibilities for progress in so many countries around the world, particularly in the global South. That's not so much a question as a statement.
¿Quieren que un poco repita el comentario que hizo Cliff? ¿O no hace falta?
Escuché la primera parte cuando refirió que claramente dijimos que sí, el gobierno de Estados Unidos se había robado unos activos, se había robado toda la compañía Circo con toda esa parte, pero me perdí un poquito en la parte final del comentario.
Sí. Bueno, en primer lugar, lo que decía de que el gobierno de Estados Unidos ha robado, incluyendo la Citgo, con las refinerías y con las estaciones, bueno, con el mecanismo este de distribución de gasolina en todo Estados Unidos. Concretamente habló del caso, por ejemplo, de la semana pasada, que cuatro buques tanques fueron pirateados prácticamente, fueron confiscados por el gobierno de Estados Unidos, aunque sabemos que formalmente tenía bandera de Liberia, que estaban en aguas internacionales y que aún así el gobierno confiscó ese petróleo. Y también mencionó el caso concreto, el caso específico de que el gobierno de Inglaterra, del Reino Unido, negó el acceso del oro de Venezuela, argumentando que solo reconoce a Juan Guaidó como el presidente de Venezuela. Y bueno, y concluyó en términos así muy claros de que ese gobierno de Estados Unidos, particularmente de Trump, pues tiene como consigna impedir el desarrollo y la evolución de muchísimos países en el sur global, Cuba, Irán, Venezuela, Nicaragua, en fin, y que pues como estadounidense siente pena, siente, le da vergüenza reconocer a este gobierno, y que lo más deseable es que para noviembre pierda Trump y cambie el gobierno de los Estados Unidos, ¿no?
Okay. Well, has a different question. The principal situation that is the government of the USA government don't like talk with another government and sovereign popular government. That is the principal point. The form of the action is different. Sometimes stolen, like Citgo. Like oil company, Citgo. Sometimes use the army, like Panama or República Dominicana. In another times, destroy the country and separate the country in two or three different, like Syria, for example. The situation, the principal point is, can be the imperialism check, ahora sí. Ajá. In this moment, when we talk, the special official of Trump stayed in Colombia. What talk in Colombia, this person? He talked with the Duque government to organize invasion to the Venezuelan territory. Yesterday, our ambassador, Samuel Moncada, write a tweet about the situation. I don't have hope about the shame of the president. Is the same, is the shame of the politics about Venezuela. I don't have a big hope about that. But I take a hope that the citizens of USA can stop the war, the military war against Venezuela. It's very important in this month, today until the election of November, stop the war. Because the war is an electoral strategy to move the emotional situation of the American citizen. Can you follow me, Cliff? The next year, we have a global scenario very difficult for us, for all country, because the COVID have an impact in the social and economic situation of the whole country. USA have 20 million of unemployed people. But Europa is same. Asia is same. We need the cooperation. I believe that when the situation is more difficult, you can find new forms to relationship. Now is the time of the solidarity, of the cooperation, and the respect. And today, to the election date on November, is very important to say to another people, American society, that the peace is necessary to the collaboration with the army, con la guerra y con las fuerzas armadas no es posible hacer cooperación entre los pueblos.
Sí, bueno, a mí me gustaría hacer una pregunta. Y esto va muy relacionado, es muy reciente, es del viernes de la semana pasada, que estuvo la declaración conjunta del Grupo de Lima, del Consejo de Europa y de 28 países, que claramente establecen que no creen en las elecciones de noviembre, que no habría cambio, y lo que ellos sugieren como una condición previa es que se establezca un gobierno temporal, un gobierno en el que no participaran ni Guaidó ni Maduro, para que pudieran organizar unas elecciones libres. Digo, esto lo menciono porque es el mensaje que aparece por todos lados y con el respaldo de muchos países. Entonces, ahí creo que se abre otro frente, ¿no? Otro frente político internacional que también tiene que enfrentar Venezuela.
Sí. Allí, lo primero, que nuestra Constitución establece la forma de hacer las elecciones. Y el respeto de las formas de cada pueblo es el principio de las relaciones internacionales. Por ejemplo, en Estados Unidos, el que saca más votos no siempre gana las elecciones. En Venezuela, el que saca más votos gana las elecciones. ¿Está mal una forma y está mal, o está mal la otra? No. Cada país se da su forma de gobierno de acuerdo a sus leyes. Es el principio de autodeterminación de los pueblos y eso debe respetarse.
Ok. Cliff, just to translate this last, I started the question saying that last Friday was a common declaration among 20 countries saying that they don't believe that the new elections in November is gonna better the situation in Venezuela. They don't believe it is democratic. So they suggest that the first thing is to establish a new government without the participation, neither Maduro nor Guaidó. So I asked Andres that for me it's a new front, a political international front who Venezuela has to face as well. And the answer of Andres is that they want respect on behalf of the countries, because every single country has the right to establish the electoral system. For instance, he stated that, for instance, in the United States, the elected president is not always the person who gets more votes, like in the case of Trump, and in the case of Venezuela, the candidate who gets more votes is the winner. So it's a self-determination principle that all countries should respect in the case of Venezuela.
Adicionalmente, yo quisiera decir que esa coalición contra Venezuela antes tenía muchos más países. Esos 28 de ahorita, creo. Creo que llegaron a 28 o 20. Antes eran más de 40. Menos de 50 siempre ha sido. Ahora son mucho menos. Y la segunda cosa que hay que resaltar como reconocimiento del fracaso que han tenido en la última fase de agresión contra Venezuela es que no llaman a Guaidó presidente. Le dicen, no es presidente encargado, no le dicen que sea presidente encargado de nada, sino que le dicen que es de la Asamblea Nacional. Es en reconocimiento de que no nunca tuvo una cualidad para ocupar el cargo. Pero además también es una muestra de debilidad, porque hubo un movimiento de restauración neoliberal en los pueblos y en los gobiernos, también hay un movimiento de restauración neoliberal